the revolution will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised. The revolution will be no rerun, brothers. The revolution will be live.
Once you've sort of opened up to a systemic analysis of U.S. culture, you start to see how capitalism works, how imperialism works, how the modern industrial system works. When you open up to that and start to see it, all of a sudden it becomes self-evident that this is, that we basically we live in a death cult in contemporary America. Right? These are unsustainable systems, and as I always say, I've done some high-level theoretical work. I don't expect everyone here to be able to follow what I'm about to say. I'm a highly trained academic, and not everybody has the intellectual power to follow. So don't feel bad if you don't understand my next pronouncement. Unsustainable systems cannot be sustained.
Wow.
High-energy, high-technology industrial systems aren't sustainable. They're drawing down the ecological capital of the planet at beyond replacement levels and creating a toxic world. Right? Once you see that, how can you not then move forward? Hi, I'm Bob.
Hi, Bob.
Yeah, it's an easy name, you should all get it. So we're here to talk about public speaking for activists, especially how you speak in public if the political ideas you're trying to put forward are considered radical, critical, out of the mainstream, dangerous, or potentially crazy to a lot of the people you might be speaking to. And so I want to start just with a couple of basics about how I think about this. And then I have a little strategy I came up with, which is pleasantly has only three components, and it's alliterative. So you don't have to take notes. It's easy to remember.
Yeah.
So let's first of all talk about what I mean by public speaking. How many of you in the next year expect to be addressing crowds of thousands at the Washington Mall in a rally or be on nationally televised news shows speaking for the progressive movement?
I'm trying to cut back.
You're trying to cut back on those, okay. But the first point is that public speaking doesn't just mean the venues where we think of traditionally political speeches. You know, Martin Luther King addressing the March on Washington or people on nationally televised programs. We all have the potential to speak politically every day of our lives. It might be in a small group around the dinner table. It might be in a church setting where you're part of a Sunday school class. It might be literally just in one-on-one conversations. All of those are public speaking opportunities. One other thing before we go into this sort of framework of thinking about how to deliver remarks in public is to remember why you're speaking. And this is a thing that I think especially very passionate people sometimes forget, is that if you're speaking politically in public, the goal is to persuade people to perhaps reconsider a position they hold or to adopt your position. The goal is to bring people toward what you believe to be the best understanding of the political world. The goal is not to be right, and the goal is not to have your say for the sake of your own emotional needs. The goal is to be effective, and that means that before you're speaking, you have to think about why you're speaking. Especially when many of us feel like those of us with critical points of view, radical points of view, don't get heard. If we have a moment where we get heard, we sometimes want to overdo it. And so it's important to remember that, to remember that you're not really speaking for yourself, in a sense. You're speaking for a political position, for a movement, for an organization. You're trying to articulate ideas that will attract people, not simply vent your own anger, your own frustration, your own need to express yourself. We all do have a need to express ourselves. I think it's part of being human. But that shouldn't dictate how you express yourself when you're trying to think of these things politically. One last sort of general comment is to remember that although we like to think we came to our political positions rationally, I know I did, I evaluated the evidence, I used logic to come to conclusions that were defensible. And that's why I know my political positions are correct, yes? Okay, well, that's sort of part of the story, but the way we come to hold political positions has as much to do with our emotions as with our reason. And that's true of everybody. It's true of every human being. Which means that trying to persuade people politically, trying to speak in public in ways that will bring people to a particular position, is not merely a question of providing the best evidence, the logic to reach the conclusion you think people should reach. It's also about being compelling in some way, meeting that need people have to make sense of the world, not just rationally, but emotionally. Which means that pretty much whenever I'm speaking, this is true not only of political context, but teaching or most anything, I'm thinking about what kind of story am I telling. I think human beings really understand the world through narratives, through stories, not through facts and not through logic. Facts and logic matter. I think they're important. I think we should pay attention to them. I think as a culture, we need to get better at evaluating facts and thinking logically. I just finished a book on the subject, so I'm rather interested in it. But we are a storytelling animal. That is true across space and time. It's one of the things that's clearly true about all human beings. We tell stories. And therefore, when you're arguing politically, engaging politically, speaking politically, it's good to think about what is the story you're telling. And that's always in the back of my mind. If you're in a situation, either planned or unexpected, where you have a chance to communicate to other people about your politics, how do you quickly think of how to go about doing that? As I said, the structure is in three parts and it's alliterative, so it'll be easy to remember. It's the three A's. And the first is audience, the second is analysis, and the third is action. So audience, analysis, and action. The first thing in not only speaking, but in writing, in any communication, is to understand who you're speaking to. And that happens at two levels, I think. One is to literally understand the demographics of the audience. Who am I speaking to? Older people, younger people, white, non-white, people with a particular religious orientation. Who am I talking to? That's the first thing, because when we talk about analysis, you're going to want to tailor the analysis to the audience, obviously. But it's not just a question of, when thinking about audience, of who people are, objectively who people are, how old they are, what they do for a living, what their philosophical positions are. It's also about thinking about who people believe they are, because again, for all of us, there's a gap between who I am and who I think I am. For instance, I think I'm a tremendously handsome middle-aged guy. I'm very committed to that. Right? So there's a little bit of a gap there, obviously. But if you think about it, again, this is not just true of others, it's true of all of us, if we're honest, is we have a sense of ourselves, an image of ourselves, an idea of ourselves, and then there's who we are. And usually our idea about ourselves is more noble than the reality of it. And so when you're trying to speak to people and understand how to speak to people, you have to not only understand who they are, but who they think they are, because often you're speaking to their own sense of their better self. You're not speaking to who they are or who you know them to be, right? A greedy, self-interested sellout hack. Right? You're speaking to that sense of themselves that is more noble, trying to encourage them to actually then make good on that sense of being that person. So it's really, really crucial to think about audience. Here's an easy example. I used to do a lot of speaking about the war, you know, anti-war activity. And you had to understand who that audience was to understand what you were going to say to them. Right. How did they see the concept of war? Was their potential opposition to the war rooted in a secular, philosophical, or a religious? Or, you know, what was going to drive them? And what was going to make them think well of themselves? That's the goal. And so that shifts very easily and obviously into analysis. There are different ways to analyze social problems and to present a political position to people. Again, the most easiest in this culture is the difference between secular and religious audiences. Let's say you're an anti-death penalty activist. There are religious arguments against the death penalty, right? Not only in Christianity and Judaism and Islam. You can find in every religious tradition the basis for an argument about why we shouldn't kill people. Right? Those arguments, if you're talking to a church group or a group you know to be very much defined by religious commitments, are going to be very different than arguments you make to the local chapter of the Revolutionary Communist Party, which tends to be not a very church-going operation. To the best of my knowledge, I don't think there is a local branch of the Revolutionary Communist Party, so I think not offending anyone here, but there you're going to appeal to left traditions, right? With an ordinary American middle-of-the-road kind of audience, you might appeal to specifically U.S.-based conceptions of politics. To a group that has a more internationalist orientation, it might be to that particular framework. So the analysis of the issue you want to present should be tailored to the audience, which is why you have to spend some time thinking about the audience. Okay. The third thing is to think about action. One of the most common complaints people have about political speaking is that the speaker offers no action. You know, lots of good analysis, lots of good critique, but what am I then supposed to do with that? Right. Now, that's a really crucial question that I'm not going to suggest has glib answers, because sometimes when we're speaking, we want people to be aware of social problems, let's say, where we don't necessarily have an easy action for them. Right. So a lot of the work we do is partly to illuminate problems, and the action that you're asking is for people to simply reflect on the nature of the problem and the analysis you're offering. Right. But in the end, it's good when one is speaking in public to have some concrete thing that people can do. People feel better that way. And the main thing here is to realize that it's not always a question of what action can you offer them that will be the most successful. Right? Sometimes I think it's okay to offer people actions that probably don't matter, but they're actions that that person can imagine engaging in and will keep that person engaged and connected to politics. So for instance, let me give you an example. How many of you think that writing a letter to congressmen, senators, and members of the House of Representatives is an effective way to fundamentally restructure American politics and economics? Okay. The general tone, reading facial expressions, is that's not a really great action to take. Right? I mean, you can write a letter to a member of Congress, and they'll take it, and they'll send you a nice reply. But we all know that those mean relatively little, except in very specific times and places. When there's a legislative moment where those members of Congress are actually reading the pulse of the electorate because they're concerned about re-election. Otherwise, letters to members of Congress don't tend to mean much. But if you are speaking to a group of people who are very new to politics and unlikely to do much more than write a letter to Congress, writing a letter to Congress is better than nothing. If by writing that letter, people think about the argument, engage in their own mind, engage with others, and sit down and do a concrete thing. Right? So when we think about actions, we may all have an idea about what needs to happen to change the system. Armed revolutionary violence, for instance. Right? We may all decide, this is just a hypothetical to anybody who's listening, I'm not advocating armed revolutionary violence at this particular moment in history. But to go into, let's say, a Sunday school class at a First Baptist church and say, and make a compelling argument about, let's say, economic injustice. And when people say, great, what should we do? To tell them you should start in your church building, stockpiling small arms, right? AK-47s, rocket-propelled grenades, because there's going to be a need for armed revolution in the coming years. It's not a compelling argument to people there. If you say, listen, we need to all sit down and make sure we write one letter to one member of Congress before we leave, That in the end may have no effect on politics as we understand it, but it may be a first step for people. And one of the things I've learned from friends of mine who are political scientists and study these things is we have to remember how scary politics is for most people. For most ordinary people, people who don't think of themselves as political, people who have no political history, even going to vote is a big deal. For some people, putting a lawn sign in their front yard in support of a candidate or a political position is a big deal. What will the neighbors think? Will my neighbors like me? Will I get invited to dinner? Will my kid be shunned at the soccer practice? I mean, these things may not be all that important to some of us here, but they are important to people. Voting is a big deal. Putting a lawn sign is a big deal. Committing to revolutionary activity for the rest of your life is a really big deal to most people. Right? So this sequence of actions that builds from where people are and what they honestly might be able to do is really important. And that's leads sometimes to a lot of us, you know, suggesting things that we really don't even think are that effective. But let me just wrap up real quickly and then we'll open it up. That's a really easy way for me, especially when I'm faced with a public speaking opportunity where I haven't written out a speech or haven't thought much about it, to quickly evaluate what might be the most effective way for me to speak. Who's my audience? Both who are they in demographic terms and who do they believe themselves to be? Second, what kind of analysis is going to be compelling to that audience given who they are and who they think they are? And third, what kind of concrete action can I offer them to keep them as connected as possible to the long-term process? So that's where I'll conclude, and we'll just open it up to questions, comments, or examples of places where you've been either successful or failed and want to figure out why. The question is can you provide a kind of stepping stones of actions? I think all of that is contextual. It depends on the moment you're in and how long you're going to be engaged with the people and how many other cracks you'll have at talking to them. So, you know, with family, for instance, people you're going to see over and over again. We usually don't think of family as a political space, but it is. It's like any other place where people get together. Right? There you can very slowly try to move people, right? And you can suggest things little by little. If you have a one-time, one-shot access to an audience, that's going to be a very different situation. And a lot of it really comes, I think, from a gut-level read of where people are at. If you say the end of capitalism and you get a lot of scared looking people, you know you got to back off. If you say, well, you know, the ultimate goal, of course, is the end of capitalism, and everybody nods, then you know you've got room to move forward. Right? So, you know, public speaking is like most every other human activity. There isn't a very detailed cookbook for how to do it. It's all contextual, and it's all based on, for the most part, I think, a gut feeling of what you're seeing. And that means not only knowing your audience, obviously, but paying attention to your audience and really reading an audience, I think. Let's talk about this question of how do you speak politically in a society where a healthy chunk of the population wants nothing to do with politics. So one part of this is obviously is what do we mean by politics? If politics, think about it, if you were 18 years old, there's some young people in the audience, maybe you can tell us, but and you looked at the world and politics was defined as what goes on in elections between Republicans and Democrats as represented to you mostly on cable television news. Think about that. Would you want to have anything to do with that if you were a decent human being? I wouldn't want to. And so when I talk to a lot of college students who say they're apolitical, what they really mean is that they are legitimately disgusted with the way politics is constructed in the mainstream. If you open up the definition of political to that basic struggle in any society for how wealth and power are distributed, that's what politics is, then all of a sudden, politics has potential to be much more interesting. And then you can also make the point that to say you're apolitical is really a misunderstanding of what politics is. To say you're apolitical is simply to say that you've surrendered your political life to other people to decide for you. If politics is that struggle for the distribution of wealth and power in a society, everybody's political by virtue of action or inaction. And if you want to be inactive in that and cede that power to others, well, the likelihood is the people you're ceding it to are not going to act in your interests or the interests of the principles you claim to propose. So in that sense, I often challenge students. I say, if you say you're apolitical, I assume you're either an idiot or a chump. You don't understand things. That's actually a technique, is to try and lay out an alternative definition and then end in a kind of humorous way, which suggests that if you really don't see these basic points, you need to rethink them. So one thing is to redefine the political, and then that opens up all sorts of space with how one can be political that doesn't suck you into the swamp of electoral politics. So we're political right here. Nonprofit groups that take on a specific community service are not necessarily just charity organizations. They can be politicized too. When you're part of a group that is feeding the homeless, you can look at that as charity work, or you can look at that as the base from which you engage in a discussion of the question of why are there homeless and why are there some people who have more than they need and some people we're feeding on the streets. All of those then become potential political spaces. Church becomes a political space. If you can get people to understand that if church is about the fundamental nature of what it means to be human being, that is an inherently political and always will be an inherently political discussion. This problem of struggling with politics in a culture that has given us such a degraded conception of politics is itself an opportunity to try and engage people to redefine the political. I don't want to suggest it's easy, in part because a mass consumption, mass spectacle culture in which there are always ways, if you want to tune out, you can, with entertainment and chemicals of various kinds. There are all sorts of obstacles to getting people to think politically. And that's part of the impediments that everybody faces who wants to be political, but especially progressive people face, right, when you want to be political. The other thing about stories is important. To convince people they should even engage in political activity, you have to tell them a story about how that's going to work, how that's going to give them a rich and fulfilling life. And the easiest way to do that is to speak about one's own experience. If you're part of a political group, if you've been a political activist, if you've been involved in community and political organizations, if the person you're talking to assumes that that's just drudgery, that's just one more unpleasant task in the world, you have to articulate a story about how it's not drudgery. There are aspects to political organizing that are not all fun and games, but by coming together with like-minded people, forming different kinds of bonds and associations, you're engaging in politics not as an act of, you know, obligation, but in a way to enhance and enrich your own life. I talk about this all the time. I talk very bluntly about the kind of friends I had before I was a political activist and the kinds of friends I have now. And the one thing that's clear to me is I got a better set of friends now. Now, obviously, I don't mean better people, you know, more. But when you're engaged with people politically, you're having conversations about what your life means. And that's a very different kind of relationship to people than conversations about whether the Longhorns are going to win on Saturday or not. And you have to be willing, I think, to tell that story. I tell that story about all the time about how I went from being a reasonably normal human being by the definition of the dominant culture to being, in some sense, a freak by the definition of the dominant culture, and why that transition has dramatically improved my quality of life. Because in the end, the one thing we know about people is if the only motivation people have to do something is because it's the right thing to do, a very small number of people will commit to that. Right? There are people morally motivated, I think, who can endure all sorts of kinds of suffering. But for most of us, our motivations to engage in political activity are not reducible to doing the right thing. A friend of mine's father was a minister, and his most commonly repeated aphorism was, "I never met a motive that wasn't mixed." Right? That most of us have mixed motives in what we do. And part of why we do things is because we have a self-interest in doing them. And so part of this articulating a different story is about articulating a different way of thinking about what's in your own self-interest. It's in my self-interest, by the definition of the dominant culture, to acquire as much wealth as possible, and with that wealth, purchase the comforts of modern industrial society. And in some crass, short-term sense, maybe that's in my self-interest. But it's also in my self-interest to help create and be part of community structures in which I find meaning. And you can't do that through the acquisition of goods and services that you pay for. You can only do that politically if politics here again is defined in that more expansive way. So the question is, what will it take for the American people to finally get fed up with the military-industrial complex? Once you see the inherent inequality that capitalism produces, right, once you see the history of imperialism and the incredible destructive capacity, how do you not wake up to that? But the fact is that, at least for me and most of us, at one point we hadn't woken up to that. And so one of the ways to answer the question in a kind of roundabout way is, how did we come into a different kind of consciousness? Not just about whether we like this president or that law, but a consciousness about the unsustainable and profoundly unjust nature of the systems in which we live. And for me, at least, it wasn't an epiphany. It didn't happen overnight. It was a slow process in which I started to change. And it's, you know, not reducible to a formula. So when will that happen? Well, it's already happening, little by little. If it hadn't happened for me, I wouldn't be here. I'd be somewhere else. And in the absence of a prediction to answer your question, the only thing I know to do is to keep plugging away at articulating in a way that's appropriate to the group you're in at the moment, some part of that story of how I became who I am. And in that sense, no matter where I'm speaking or what I'm doing, I'm telling some version of the Bob Jensen story. Not in a self-indulgent, egotistical way, but some version of how I got from where I was when I was born and raised in North Dakota in a completely conventional world, defined by completely normal, quote-unquote, American values, how I got to being who I am. Connecting to and trying to pressure elected officials, for the most part, I find to be inadequate, but there are times and places. My own experience as an organizer, as actually getting involved in political organizing, came in such a campaign back in the late 90s. Before we invaded and destroyed Iraq, we were starving the Iraqis to death through an economic embargo. And there was a campaign to try and pressure the U.S. government to lift that embargo. And that included a legislative component. It included writing letters to Congress. It never got far enough to know whether or not we had a shot at it, because then we bombed them into oblivion first. But, you know, that, it was hard for me to say, oh, don't bother talking to your, don't try to get a meeting with your legislator. Organize in some abstract way toward some revolutionary future. We build things in ways that we, again, retroactively we tell a story about, but at the moment we're making decisions, we often are, you know, taking our best guess at what might be effective. And your best guess is likely to be wrong more often than it's right, and that's okay as long as that best guess kept as many people together as possible, kept the idea alive, kept the analysis alive, kept it circulating. I think one of the things that's kind of underneath all of this is a recognition that we're not going to win anytime soon. If by we mean people with a systemic analysis of the structures, you know, imperialism, capitalism, patriarchy, white supremacy, the industrial model, those are the targets in the largest sense, right? And those aren't going away anytime soon. We aren't even making short-term gains at this point. We're in a kind of holding action. For people with truly, I think, radical and revolutionary ideas, it's okay to say the best we might be able to do is to be a kind of saving remnant of an alternative conception. And when the political conditions shift, we're there. I mean, sometimes surviving is a great victory. if you can keep ideas alive. And you know, just to remember contemporary history, I always use the example of the year I was born, 1958. Some people here are old enough to remember. 1958 was a pretty grim time in the United States. There was really no meaningful freedom of speech and freedom of association. The year before I was born was the first time the US Supreme Court said that the Communist Party had a right to exist in the United States. Prior to that, you could be jailed for being a member of the Communist Party, which means you have no political rights of association and speech. Much of America that wasn't white had no claim to citizenship. Women were seen still as essentially a kind of adjunct to men. The gay-lesbian movement didn't even exist in any significant form at that moment. The environmental movement wasn't even a sort of part of the discussion at that point. All right. If you looked at 1950, if on the day I was born, you looked around and asked what's the potential for radical change in America, you'd get laughed out of the room. What are you, crazy? Right? We're locked down in this country. Right? Within 10 years of my birth, literally the entire world was on fire. In 1968, the government of France almost fell. The power structure in the United States was so terrified of these configurations of challenges, the American Indian Movement, the Black Panthers, the New Left, the student movement, they were so terrified that they were engaged in out and out police state activities to try and undermine those movements. Yeah, I mean, so within 10 years, the political terrain on which radicals in the United States were working changed dramatically. And that's the hopeful part. Now, the less than hopeful part is the system found a way pretty quickly to contain and destroy that challenge. But, you know, that's history. History is important, and, you know, it's kind of a truism that, you know, one of the ways the dominant culture controls us is by making sure nobody is ever taught an authentic history of the country, let alone of the world. And that's a reminder, if I can use Roger's point as a jumping off. When we're talking about action, a lot of people are frustrated and want to act in ways that are tangible and immediate and powerful. But I think we should remember that conversation is in itself an action. Studying is an action, right? That part of what we need to do is not simply act, but continue the process of not only educating others, but educating ourselves. And so it doesn't often feel like it's going to get us very far to organize a book group. But organizing a book group can be a very powerful tool, right? And reading history. So remembering that, in fact, from the beginning that concentrated power asserted itself in the United States of America, there was a reaction. That goes back to the founding of the country. Right. The minute that the United States gained its independence from Britain and the relatively small elite landowning and merchant class started to assert its dominance, there was a reaction, Shays' Rebellion. And then there was a counter-reaction. That this has gone on throughout U.S. history. In fact, it goes on throughout world history. It doesn't mean that if we just wait, sort of sit back and wait, everything's going to work out because there's going to be these cycles. But it reminds us that those cycles exist. And so, for a nation where so many people have never heard of any of this, right, it's a powerful action to organize people in small groups, to read books together, right, to practice public speaking by sharing responsibilities for preparing educational material. I mean, all of these things are really, really important. And as someone who's taught now for 20 years at the University of Texas, probably the scariest thing I see is that every year it seems I can assume less from my students about basic knowledge of history, which isn't to say I think students are dumber today. It's the culture in which they're being socialized. That I've had to dramatically shift the way I teach in 20 years to, in a sense, start at a lower level conceptually and historically in every class I teach because I can't assume any common knowledge anymore. And so providing that common knowledge can really be powerful. You know, on the left, it's kind of a joke. I used to say that if you ask most leftists, especially white leftists in a kind of tradition in the United States, how did you get politicized? That I wish I had a dollar for everyone who started that sentence by saying, well, I read this book by Chomsky, or I read this book by Zinn. For how many of us, right? Now, that's a specific kind of type of person who gets politicized that way. But that reminds us of the power of thinking, of reading, of educating ourselves and helping to educate each other. And no matter what's going on in the dominant culture, that can go forward. Right? You might not have a chance to win on any policy proposal at the legislative level for the next 5 years in what you're concerned about, but there's still that political activity that's possible. The question is about the reality of ecological decline and the way that that changes the equation, and I agree with everything you said, that throughout human history, or at least the last 10,000 years of human history, as long as there's been so-called civilization, people have struggled against concentrated wealth and power. And in that history, we see that every formation of concentrated wealth and power eventually gives way. All empires fall eventually. But if the time frame for the particular contemporary empire falling is 100 years and we only have 25 years left, it's game over, basically. Is education going to be meaningful? The answer is no. But every other activity you can imagine is also not going to be meaningful, which is a kind of roundabout way of saying my own conclusion is that we're screwed. That the level of damage to the ecosphere is such at this point that we are likely past what some scientists are calling planetary boundaries on certain measures of the health of the ecosphere. That the notion of tipping points, where collapse doesn't come overnight, right, like a science fiction movie, but it comes gradually. But there are tipping points at which we really don't recover. And we are probably at or past many of those. I think that that evidence is pretty compelling. And I think the conclusion one reaches from that, if you're honest, is that we cannot win. If by win we mean fundamentally restructuring human society to be sustainable, compatible with the demands of so-called nature. Right? I think we've lost that one. Right? Now, it's hard to say that in public. It's especially hard, I've found, to say that to people who have small children, right? Who have made a decision to bring into the world people who are going to suffer and die under conditions probably far more grotesque than we can imagine sitting here. All right. As you can see, this isn't a great conversation starter at your average dinner party, but it is reality. Right? And so how do we bring that into those conversations, and then how do we plan our own activities based on that reality? Whenever I think people want to talk about this, I say that for me what it means is that it's time to give up hope. Right? And to understand that hope in the sense that we can revive, reform, remake these systems in some time frame that's compatible with sustainability is probably extremely naive. And so by giving up hope, I don't mean, let's all get a 12-pack and go see what's on ESPN for the rest of our lives and just veg out. It means redefining what success is. My own view is success is not saving the world in that sense. Success is figuring out what comes after. Right? My own view is that there's going to be a process that's already started in the most vulnerable parts of the world. A process exacerbated by climate change and other ecological strains that is leading to a kind of dystopic science fiction future that's already happening in the present in certain places. If you want to see what that looks like, the journalist Christian Parenti has written a book last year called Tropic of Chaos that looks at the most ecologically and politically vulnerable parts of the world, which happen to be around the equator, and how the climate change-driven crises there are already producing this breakdown. And at some point, that breakdown is going to move from those, what we might call marginal places to the center of, the power in the world, which means here. And I'm 53 years old. Will I see the most dramatic consequences of that in my lifetime? I don't know. I'm not one for prediction. But I'm pretty sure my kid is going to see those consequences. Right? And if those can't really be stopped, right? If capitalism, imperialism, the industrial model of human existence are not going to be transformed in a time frame that's meaningful, then it's time to start thinking about what comes next. What conception of what it means to be human, what the good life means, the basic philosophical and what I would call theological questions. And so whatever I'm doing in terms of political organizing these days, I want some component of it to be that question. That question can't be introduced everywhere because people everywhere are not going to want to hear it. But in the places it can be introduced, I think it's worth doing. Much of what I just said is on my mind because on Sunday at the church I go to, which is a progressive church in Austin, I'm going to be the guest preacher because our minister is on vacation. And that's exactly what I'm going to talk about. Right? It's a sermon, I like my sermon title. I don't know if the content's any good, but the title is Hope is for the Lazy. Something like coming to terms with life in a dead world. And that's how I think about it. Right? It's a dead world. The systems that define our society are dead. Right? They're literally producing death. Right? And we're not going to transcend them. We're going to have to figure out a whole different way of thinking. The environmental movement that pushed for things like the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, legislation that demanded a more responsible approach to specific places, right? That had effects. There are places where the water is cleaner and the air is cleaner in the United States because of that, right? But the environmental movement to try to achieve that also made decisions about not attacking capitalism by focusing on achievable goals in the short term. And at the same time that the air and water where you live and in other places is cleaner, the system that's destroying the overarching ecosphere has intensified. So both things are true. There have been localized improvements in all sorts of places, especially when there was a strong environmental movement. Austin is an example of that to some degree. But the system that defines the planet has not only continued, but intensified. The consumption of fossil fuels has increased. The effects of that consumption are now clear. And so it's a recognition that localized actions are important. They often dramatically improve the lives of real people and living creatures beyond humans, and that's not trivial. But if we aren't at the same time that we're engaged in those localized actions, also identifying the nature of the system and trying to argue for a radical vision of an alternative system, in the long term, we're going to lose. And we are losing. And we have lost some of those battles, probably in a way that from which we're not going to recover. And so in a sense, I think we're both right. And the corrective you provide is remembering what human agency can accomplish. The corrective I apply is to remember that that goes on in a long historical arc that's been heading in the wrong direction. And we not only have to think about how are we going to organize the world if things turn out well, we have to think about how are we going to organize the world if things continue on that arc. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for the comments.
Justice!
Blood, blood.
Love humanity. Love humanity. Cut out your sanity. Cut it out. Killing people for vanity. Stop killing people for vanity.